This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Max Milo Editions present The Russian Art of War: How the West Led Ukraine to Defeat by Jacques BAUD. Why is Ukraine losing the war against Russia? How do both sides think and operate? What were the mistakes on both sides? How did the West contribute to the Ukrainian defeat? To answer these and many other questions, Jacques BAUD draws on official information as well as American, Western, and Russian documents. He explains how Russia understands and conducts the war. He shows how the West's inability to grasp this reality and its determination to weaken Russia has backfired in Ukraine. Following on from the bestsellers Putin, Game Master, Operation Z and Ukraine Between War and Peace, whose analytical work has been acclaimed worldwide and translated into several languages, the author returns to the war in Ukraine. He explains how Russia waged the war and reveals how the image portrayed by the West led to Ukraine's failure. Jacques BAUD was a member of Swiss Strategic Intelligence, a specialist in Eastern Europe and former head of doctrine for UN peacekeeping operations. During the Cold War, he worked on Soviet military art and the war in Afghanistan. Within NATO, he was involved in programs in Ukraine, notably after the 2014 Maidan Revolution. In addition to his major works on the conflict in Ukraine, he is the author of several books on intelligence, war and terrorism, including Governor Par Les Fake News, Vanka, Le Terrorisme Jihadiste and L'Affaire Navalny, all published by Max Milo. Notes and illustrations are available on electronic and paper editions of the book. 1. Introduction. In 1973, while on vacation in Italy with my family, we stopped off at the monastery of Monte Cassino, the scene of a violent battle in 1943. I remember spending long minutes in front of the grave of a young Canadian who died at the age of 18, the same age I was at the time. 50 years later, on the occasion of the visit of President Volodymyr Zelensky, the Canadian Parliament gave a standing ovation to a survivor of the 14th Grenadier Division, Galician, of the Waffen SS, who fought against the Soviets and took part in atrocities against Jews. Anthony Rota, President of the Parliamentary Assembly, pointed out that this veteran fought for Ukrainian independence against the Russians and continues to support the truth today. A few days later, Rota awkwardly tried to justify himself, claiming that he didn't know the background of this soldier, which is a lie, since he had invited him and the other guests had been duly vetted and approved. To top it all off, Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister, could think of nothing better than to blame it all on Russian propaganda and disinformation. One wonders if they're doing it on purpose, or if they're just totally retarded. This incident illustrates several things that characterize the Western approach to the conflict in Ukraine. First of all, Rota's justifications don't change the bottom line. All Canadian parliamentarians glorified those who fought for Canada's allies in the Second World War. In fact, they spat on the grave of this young Canadian who was fighting the same enemy as the Soviets. In support, Zelensky, who knew full well what it meant to fight the Russians in the Second World War, himself applauded this former Waffen SS man. Let's not forget that 7 million Ukrainians fought the Third Reich on the side of the USSR and the Allies. Secondly, these parliamentarians gave a former Nazi a standing ovation without even asking questions. Like sheep. By neglecting their duty of care and acting without knowledge or understanding, they are all, without exception, examples of an ignorant political class without honor, irresponsible, profoundly incapable of reflection and humanity. They are a disgrace to democracy. Thirdly, this incident shows the ambiguity of the situation of Ukrainians who owe their first independence to the Third Reich, which makes the oppressors of Western Europe the liberators of Ukrainians. The problem is that the Manichaean world in which we live cannot accommodate these complex relationships. This leads to a form of negationism that has taken hold in our media, among our journalists and our politicians. Fourthly, Anthony Rota didn't say that the veteran had fought Soviets which would have been a reference to their ideology since this was the USSR, but Russians, singling out an ethnic group. The parliamentarians gave this a standing ovation, highlighting the common ground between the Nazis of yesteryear, the neo-Nazis of today, the Canadian parliamentarians and the rest. Hatred of Russians, the driving force behind the Ukrainian conflict. For not one of our journalists has spoken out against the sanctions targeting the Russian population, the murders and assassinations of Russian personalities, the actions targeting Russian art and artists, even to the point of renaming paintings in our museums. All mainstream media journalists, without exception, have accepted a practice that seemed to have been forgotten since the Holocaust, condemning individuals for what they are, not for what they do. Paradoxically, I don't associate the vast majority of Ukrainians with this hatred, because many of them don't share it, even though the war polarizes people's minds. I also note that the Ukrainian press often contradicts what our journalists say. That's why the incident at the Canadian Parliament is more than an anecdote. It's the image of a Western political class adrift, of media without faith or law, of politicians and journalists who live off the blood of others, and, as we shall see, in particular that of Ukrainians. This book, like its predecessors, is not about giving good points to one side or the other. It does not seek to justify either side in the conflict, but to explain what they are doing and why they are doing it. Naturally, in an intellectual context where everything the Russians do is considered wrong, stupid and bad, explaining what they do is enough to be cast as an apologist. Like all conflicts, Ukraine was the scene of unbridled disinformation. The phenomenon is not unusual, but here it took on an almost cartoonish quality. From the outset, the Western narrative revolved around the idea that Russia cannot and must not win this war. This is demonstrated by the hearing of Michel Goya, a colonel in the French army, before a committee of the French Senate in November 2022. Without the slightest knowledge of Russian military doctrine, with a very limited understanding of the art of operations, and even of the inner workings of the Atlantic Alliance, he analyzed the war in terms of what a French soldier would do. Beyond navel gazing, he illustrates a very Western way of understanding war based on our own logic, not on that of our adversary. This is what led to the disasters of 1914 and 1940 in France, and to the failure of operations in the Middle East and Sahel. At the hearing of General Bruno Clermont on December 7, 2022, Senator L.R. Cedric Perard perfectly illustrated our inability to understand war in any other way than the way we do. The Russians made a monumental mistake at the outset by not operating as Western doctrine would have it, i.e., by bombing the areas which today allow the Ukrainians to respond to them. In other words, he was surprised that Russia doesn't apply our operational principles. The inability to imagine several solutions to the same problem, and to understand that others may have a different, or even more effective, solution, is an expression of Western ethnocentrism. This is exactly why Mali and Niger have asked French troops to leave their territory. The particularity of this conflict is that, on the Western side, the aim was not to help Ukraine win it, but to force Russia to lose it. The ultimate aim is not so much to win back territory, as to bring about Vladimir Putin's downfall. That's why, in August 2023, Ukraine's inability to carry out its counter-offensive made the West fear that it was losing control of its narrative. Worse, as the New York Times noted, US officials say they fear Ukraine has become reluctant to take casualties. This is what Andrés Manuel López Obrador, president of Mexico, summed up so lucidly in June 2022 about NATO and EU policy towards Ukraine. "We supply the weapons, you supply the corpses. It's immoral." For, from the Western point of view, the course of the conflict depends on the narrative. From the outset of the Russian operation in Ukraine, Western discourse created a false sense of superiority, leading Ukraine to underestimate the reality of the Russian threat. We will seek to restore a balance to the information that our media and their so-called journalists have deliberately falsified. Deeply dishonest and bloodthirsty, they manage to contradict information that even Ukrainian journalists have given. In this conflict, by rejecting the deontology of the Munich Charter, our media have abandoned their ethics and their honor. Comfortably ensconced in their editorial offices, they have done everything in their power to ensure that the conflict is prolonged and lives wasted. And this responsibility predates February 24, 2022. Our media and experts have literally pushed Ukraine into a conflict, denying it any negotiating option, but convincing it that Russia is an adversary, one that it is capable of defeating. They are the most detestable, and I hope this book will help make Ukrainians and Russians realize how dishonest they have been with them. The misunderstanding of the conflict in Ukraine is partly the result of the intellectual and semantic muddle with which we try to explain it. Notions of strategy, tactics, and, newly, operative art are boldly mixed together, making it possible to castigate the Russian approach and explain its impending defeat, which the West is still waiting for. Today, the Western narrative has gradually collapsed before the reality of the facts, and what was described as conspiracism in 2022 has become reality. As with any conflict, it can only be understood by trying to grasp the perceptions and logics of the protagonists. In the pages that follow, we will return to the way Russia sees and wages war. Our military's inability to understand the reality of the situation in Ukraine is not only worrying for the future of our armies, it is literally one of the main reasons for the Ukrainian defeat. Chapter 2. Russian military thought. Throughout the Cold War period, the Soviet Union saw itself as the spearhead of a historical struggle that would lead to a confrontation between the capitalist system and progressive forces. This perception of a permanent and inescapable war led the Soviets to study war in a quasi-scientific way, and to structure this thinking into an architecture of military thought that has no equal in the Western world. The problem with the vast majority of our so-called military experts is their inability to understand the Russian approach to war. It's the result of an approach we've already seen in waves of terrorist attacks. The adversary is so stupidly demonized that we fail to understand his way of thinking. As a result, we are unable to develop strategies, articulate our forces, or even equip them for the realities of war. The corollary of this approach is that our frustrations are translated by unscrupulous media into a narrative that feeds hatred and increases our vulnerability. We are thus unable to find rational and effective solutions to the problem. The way Russians understand conflict is holistic. In other words, they see the processes that develop and lead to the situation at any given moment. This explains why Vladimir Putin's speeches invariably include a return to history. In the West, we tend to focus on the immediate moment X and try to see how it might evolve. We want an immediate response to the situation we see right now. The idea that, from the understanding of how the crisis arose, comes the way to resolve it, is totally foreign to the West. In September 2023, an English-language journalist even pulled out the duck test for me. If it looks like a duck, swims like a duck, and quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. In other words, all they need is an image that matches their prejudices to assess a situation. The reality is far more subtle than the duck model. In Newsweek, an analyst at the Defense Intelligence Agency, DIA, the American equivalent of France's Direction du Renseignement Militaire, DRM, notes, "The way in which Russia is waging this brutal war differs from the widely held view that Vladimir Putin wants to destroy Ukraine and inflict maximum civilian casualties, but rather reveals the Russian leader's strategic balancing act. The reason why the Russians are better than the West in Ukraine is that they see the conflict as a process, whereas we see it as a series of separate actions. The Russians see events as a film, we see them as photographs. They see the forest, while we focus on the trees. That's why we place the start of the conflict on February 24, 2022, or the start of the Palestinian conflict on October 7, 2023. We discard the contexts that bother us and wage conflicts we don't understand. That's why we lose our wars. Russian military doctrine. Doctrinal elements. Russian military doctrine is the subject of a great deal of study and debate in Russia itself. Our Western perception of this thinking is extremely simplistic and distorted by the American prism. We will not deal here with all aspects of Russian thought and doctrine. We will concentrate on that which is linked to the Ukrainian conflict and the lessons we can learn from it. Principles of military art. All countries articulate their military thinking or policy around general principles which guide the design of their defense and operations. The number of principles varies from country to country and is very similar. In Russia, unsurprisingly, the principles of the military art of the Soviet forces inspired those currently in use. Availability to carry out assigned missions. Focus on solving a specific mission. Surprise unconventionality of military action vis-à-vis the enemy. Purpose determines a set of tasks and the level of resolution of each task. Totality of available resources determines how the mission is resolved and the objective achieved. Correlation of forces. Consistency of leadership, unity of command. Economy of forces, resources, time and space. Supporting and restoring combat capability. Freedom to maneuver. It should be noted that these principles apply not only to the implementation of military action as such. They are also applicable as a system of thought to other non-operational activities. An honest analysis of the conflict in Ukraine would have identified these various principles and drawn useful conclusions for Ukraine. But none of the self-proclaimed experts on TV were intellectually able to do this. Thus, Westerners are systematically surprised by the Russians in the fields of technology, e.g., hypersonic weapons, doctrine, e.g., operative art, and economics, e.g., resilience to sanctions. In a way, the Russians are taking advantage of our prejudices to exploit the principle of surprise. We can see this in the Ukrainian conflict, where the Western narrative led Ukraine to completely underestimate Russian capabilities, which was a major factor in its defeat. That's why Russia didn't really try to counter this narrative and let it play out. The belief that we are superior makes us vulnerable. Force correlation. Russian military thought is traditionally linked to a holistic approach to warfare, which involves the integration of a large number of factors in the development of a strategy. This approach is embodied in the concept of correlation of forces, sutnoseni sil, often translated as balance of forces or ratio of forces. This concept is understood by Westerners only as a quantity of a quantitative nature, limited to the military domain. However, in Soviet thought, the correlation of forces reflects a more holistic reading of war. There are several criteria for assessing the correlation of strengths. In the economic sphere, the factors usually compared are gross national product per capita, labor productivity, the dynamics of economic growth, the level of industrial production, particularly in high-tech sectors, the technical infrastructure of the production tool, the resources and degree of qualification of the workforce, the number of specialists, and the level of development of theoretical and applied sciences. In the military field, the factors compared are the quantity and quality of armaments, the firepower of the armed forces, the fighting and moral qualities of the soldiers, the level of staff training, the organization of the troops and their combat experience, the character of the military doctrine and the methods of strategic, operative, and tactical thinking. In the political sphere, the factors that come into consideration are the breadth of the social base of state authority, its organization, the constitutional procedure for relations between the government and legislative bodies, the ability to make operational decisions, and the degree and character of popular support for domestic and foreign policy. Finally, in assessing the strength of the international movement, the factors taken into consideration are its quantitative composition, its influence with the masses, its position in the political life of each country, the principles and norms of relations between its components and the degree of their cohesion. In other words, the assessment of the situation is not limited to the balance of forces on the battlefield, but takes into account all the elements that have an impact on the evolution of the conflict. Thus, for their special military operation, the Russian authorities had planned the ability to support the war effort through the economy, without moving to a war economy regime. Thus, unlike in Ukraine, there was no interruption in the tax and welfare mechanisms. This is why the sanctions applied on Russia in 2014 had a double positive effect. The first was the realization that they were not only a short-term problem, but above all, a medium and long-term opportunity. They encouraged Russia to produce goods it had previously preferred to buy abroad. The second was the signal that the West would increasingly use economic weapons as a means of pressure in the future. It therefore became imperative, for reasons of national independence and sovereignty, to prepare for more far-reaching sanctions affecting the country's economy. In reality, it has long been known that sanctions do not work. Logically enough, they had the opposite effect, acting as protectionist measures for Russia, which was thus able to consolidate its economy, as had been the case after the 2014 sanctions. A strategy of sanctions might have borne fruit if the Russian economy had indeed been the equivalent of the Italian or Spanish economy, i.e., with a high level of debt, and if the entire planet had acted in unison to isolate Russia. The inclusion of the correlation of forces in the decision-making process is a fundamental difference from Western decision-making processes, which are linked more to a policy of communication than to a rational approach to problems. This explains, for example, Russia's limited objectives in Ukraine, where it is not seeking to occupy the entire territory, as the correlation of forces in the western part of the country would be unfavorable to it. At each control level, force correlation is part of situation assessment. At the operational level, it is defined as follows. The result of comparing the quantitative and qualitative characteristics of the forces and resources, subunits, units, weapons, military equipment, etc., of one's own troops, forces, and those of the enemy. It is calculated on an operational and tactical scale throughout the area of operations, in the main and other directions, in order to determine the degree of objective superiority of one of the opposing camps. Assessing the correlation of forces enables you to make an informed decision about an operation, battle, and to establish and maintain the necessary superiority over the enemy for as long as possible when decisions are redefined, modified, during military combat operations. This simple definition is the reason why the Russians committed themselves with forces inferior to those of Ukraine in February 2022, or why they withdrew from Kiev, Kharkov and Kherson in March, September and October 2022. We'll come back to this later. Nuclear war. Ongoing evolution. In 1945, the USSR won the race to Berlin. It emerged victorious from the war, but unlike the United States, it was bloodless. In the United States and Great Britain, some leaders saw this as an opportunity to resume the offensive towards Moscow, since it was thought that Stalin had the same intention towards the Atlantic. But the time was not ripe for the resumption of hostilities, and the Cold War began. Today, those who claim that Russia has expansionist intentions are simply transposing, without taking the context into account, the Marxist thinking that guided Soviet policy. In this scheme, the USSR saw itself as the spearhead of the class struggle, engaged in a permanent and systemic war with the West, as part of a historical process of struggle against capitalism. Until Stalin's death, the USSR's strategic military thinking was dominated by the idea that its security would only be guaranteed by a victory of socialism over capitalism, and that confrontation between the two systems was inevitable. Soviet strategists spoke of the principle of the inevitability of war, neizbeznost vojny. This idea remained until the 20th Congress of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union in February 1956, when, under the impetus of Nikita Khrushchev, the USSR adopted the principle of peaceful coexistence. From then on, this was known as the non-inevitability of war. This did not prevent Westerners from preparing for possible Soviet aggression, although American documents, now declassified, show that the Soviets had no intention of invading Europe. Recently declassified Soviet documents, articles and minutes of meetings indicate that the Soviet leadership had no intention of invading Europe. In the USSR, on the other hand, the fear of new Western invasion attempts on its territory remained very real, prompting it to adopt a policy of dissuasion. However, the experiences of the First and Second World Wars gave rise to fears that the West would invade the USSR if it appeared militarily weak. In 1949, the USSR acquired nuclear weapons. This led to the creation of NATO the same year, with the aim of placing Western Europe under the US nuclear umbrella. At this stage, nuclear war was mainly considered at the strategic level, and tactical nuclear weapons were not yet on the agenda. The risk was that the two nuclear powers would be pushed towards direct confrontation and nuclear exchange, resulting in mutual assured destruction, MAD. The indivisibility of safety. One of the special features of nuclear weapons is that they can cause considerable, even existential, damage, leaving no time to find a response, or even to exploit a final negotiating space. The asymmetrical situation of the USA and Russia means that the former can use Europe as a buffer zone, while Russia could very quickly find itself faced with an existential problem. This is why, since the end of the Second World War, a constant feature of Russia's defense policy has been to maintain a buffer zone between NATO and its territory, also known as the Glacis in French and the Vorfeld in German, the aim being to give more space to a conventional conflict and prevent it from becoming nuclear too quickly. During the Cold War, the Warsaw Treaty Organization, known in the West as the Warsaw Pact, constituted this space. With NATO's eastward expansion and the progressive denunciation of disarmament treaties by the United States since 2002, this space has disappeared. For this reason, Russia has modified its doctrine of nuclear engagement, enabling it to make more rapid use of nuclear weapons. It's important to emphasize here that Russia is less afraid of NATO's expansion than of the United States' exploitation of it. In 1952, Turkey's accession to NATO brought the alliance close to the USSR, alarming the Soviets. However, they did not react. It was only 9 years later when the Americans deployed PGM-19 Jupiter nuclear missiles in Turkey that the crisis erupted. At the time, the Americans did not yet have the technology to build intercontinental missiles, and the Jupiters were only an improved version of the German V-2s, with a range of 2,400 to 2,700 kilometers. Americans don't like it when people do to them what they do to others. The Soviets understood this and began deploying missiles in Cuba, triggering a violent US reaction known as the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962. Eventually, the Americans, caught up in their own game, were forced to withdraw their missiles from Turkey. The USSR won. Until the early 2000s, new NATO members were accepted with euphoria and without any strategic reflection, because Russia and China were weak. Today, the situation is radically different. The problem is that the legitimate security concerns of European countries are bringing American nuclear power closer to the Russian border, increasing the likelihood of nuclear war in the event of heightened tension. The problems of one country can quickly become those of the whole alliance, as in 1914. In 2002, when the USA withdrew from the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty, ABM Treaty, and began negotiations with Poland, the Czech Republic, and Romania to install dual-use launchers, anti-ballistic and nuclear, the Russians perceived a direct threat. This is what Vladimir Putin said in Munich in 2007, and what he underlined at his press conference with Emmanuel Macron in Moscow on February 7, 2022. The problem is that we're not listening to what is telling us. This is not a completely new issue. It was already identified in 1949 by the authors of the Washington Treaty, NATO's Founding Act, Article 10 of which states that the parties may, by unanimous agreement, invite to accede to the treaty any other European state likely to promote the development of the principles of the present treaty and to contribute to the security of the North Atlantic area. Any state so invited may become a party to the treaty by depositing its instrument of accession with the government of the United States of America. The latter will inform each of the parties of the deposit of each instrument of accession. In other words, countries are invited, insofar as they can contribute to the security of the North Atlantic region. Clearly, the criterion is not the security of each individual member country, but the collective security of the region. This is what the New Europe countries have failed to understand. They were accepted into NATO at a time when Russia was weakened. Today, NATO offers them a kind of insurance under whose shelter they pursue ultra-nationalist and discriminatory policies towards their Russian-speaking minorities, with the declared aim of provoking Russia. In fact, their membership of NATO and the EU is fundamentally destabilizing for the European continent. In fact, even within the NATO military, their reputation is particularly bad, as I have seen. This also means that, potentially, every country in the Euro-Atlantic area can be a member, but that the alliance is under no obligation to accept every country that wishes to join. This is one of the reasons why Ukraine's entry into NATO is so hotly debated within the alliance itself. But an essential principle of Russian security policy is that of the indivisibility of security, nedelimost bezopasnosti. It is not exclusively Russian and has been accepted by OSCE members and is enshrined in the Istanbul Document, 1999, and the Astana Declaration, 2010. The safety of each participating state is inextricably linked to that of all the others. In other words, the security of one country cannot be achieved at the expense of another. One example was the presence of the French tactical nuclear Pluton missiles, then the Hades, which threatened the existence of friendly populations in Germany and Switzerland. However, when NATO, and the United States in particular, deploys armaments, thereby reducing the warning and early warning times of a neighboring country, in this case, Russia, this principle is not respected. What bothers the Russians, therefore, is not so much the proximity of NATO, as the willingness of the Americans to deploy nuclear weapons there. This is because the installation of nuclear weapons, point blank, makes it virtually impossible to implement a bilateral crisis management mechanism. Indeed, it was in the wake of the Cuban crisis that the famous red telephone was set up between Washington and Moscow. Neither a telephone, let alone a red telephone, but an emergency communication channel designed to facilitate crisis management. What's astonishing is that Westerners don't seem to have perceived this risk. NATO's advance has been seen as a geographical success, but no strategic conclusions have been drawn. And yet, by moving closer to the Russian border, NATO is also removing its own early warning capability. The RAND Corporation has clearly warned the US government of this problem. While placing strike assets close to Russia would reduce the time available to Russian military commanders to detect and respond to air and cruise missile attacks, it would leave US and Allied commanders even less time to detect and respond to Russian missile attacks against assets currently located at these bases. This combination of mutual vulnerability and risk of surprise attack could be seriously destabilizing in the event of a crisis, particularly if tactical nuclear weapons are also stored at nearby sites. Deploying missiles close to the Russian border has nothing whatsoever to do with NATO's defensive or non-defensive vocation, as the alliance runs exactly the same risk. This is what Vladimir Putin tried to explain in his press conference on February 7, 2022, following Emmanuel Macron's visit to Moscow. On March 25, 2023, on the occasion of Alexander Lukashenko's visit to Russia, Vladimir Putin declared on the Russia 24 channel that the Belarusian president had asked him to deploy tactical nuclear weapons on its territory. The reason given was Britain's decision to supply depleted uranium anti-tank shells. But as always, the reality is more complex. First of all, Vladimir Putin is merely repeating Lukashenko's words, as the Russians make no doctrinal distinction between tactical, operational, and strategic nuclear weapons. Moreover, the weapons mentioned have ranges in excess of 1,000 kilometers, whereas, traditionally, nuclear weapons with ranges of 150 to 500 kilometers are considered tactical. The Belarusian request came after a number of events that our media carefully avoided mentioning, notably the attitude of Poland, nostalgic for its past greatness and seeking to reconstitute the Intermarium. It has its sights set on the western part of Belarus, which it considers to belong to it historically, and whose reconquest is part of its security policy. This is why it supports the opposition in Belarus politically, materially and ostensibly, with the blessing of the USA. On January 11, 2023, the signing of a joint declaration by Poland, Ukraine and Lithuania forming the Lublin Triangle, a military mini-alliance linked to NATO, worried Lukashenko. Moreover, as the situation in Ukraine deteriorated and Russia's predicted collapse faded, the US began to work on regime change in Belarus in order to achieve a small success. On March 22, 2023, Wendy Sherman, Assistant Secretary of State, met with Svetlana Tikhanovskaya, leader of the Belarusian militant opposition, to coordinate their actions. As the American media outlet, The Atlantic Council pointed out, the United States is seeking to instrumentalize the Belarusian opposition for the benefit of Ukraine. But another more significant event explains the Russian decision, the deployment, at the end of February 2023, of four American strategic nuclear bombers of the B-52H STRATOFORTRESS type at Moron Air Base, Spain, to send a message to Russia. On March 11, 2023, one of these aircraft, callsign Noble 61, carried out a simulated nuclear attack missile strike drill against the city of St. Petersburg from the Gulf of Finland. Reported by the Russian opposition website Medusa on the same day, the information was, obviously, not picked up by any mainstream Western media. Yet it was probably what prompted Vladimir Putin, 2 weeks later, to accede to President Lukashenko's request to deploy nuclear weapons on Belarusian territory. Russia's decision was the occasion for further elucidations by our experts, who played with words. Swiss expert Alexandra Votravers declared on RTS that this was an arms transfer, which would contravene the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, NPT. Not true. As confirmed on the same day by the Russian opposition media Medusa, Vladimir Putin clarified that this was not a transfer but only a deployment. The essential difference is that these weapons remain under Russia's exclusive authority. In other words, Russia is no different from the USA, with its nuclear weapons depots in Germany, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Turkey. Russia is replaying the Cuban missile scenario in Belarus. As the same causes have the same effects, the American administration did an about-face. On June 2, 2023, Jake Sullivan, Joe Biden's national security advisor, declared, "The Biden administration is ready to discuss unconditionally with Russia a future nuclear arms control framework." As in the Cuban crisis, the Americans only understand the hard way, instead of trying to bring about change through cooperation, as was successfully done during the Cold War, they try to do it through confrontation and exclusion. Russian nuclear doctrine. On France 5 on October 27, 2022, in a program devoted to the dirty bomb that Russia accused Ukraine of developing, criminologist Alain Bauer explained that the Russians consider tactical nuclear weapons to be conventional weapons. This is totally false. In fact, Russian doctrine does not single out tactical nuclear weapons. Russia has a range of nuclear weapons of varying strengths, to be used according to circumstances and objectives. But they consider the use of nuclear weapons, whatever their strength, to be of a strategic nature, as they can provoke a nuclear escalation. In an article on this subject, Diego A. Ruiz Palma, head of the Comparative Assessment Section of NATO's Defense Policy and Planning Division, recalled that the Soviets saw the use of nuclear weapons only as a last resort. As early as 1966, the Central Intelligence Agency had identified a growing Soviet interest in conducting military operations without the use of nuclear weapons. This was demonstrated by the Dnieper 67 maneuvers and confirmed by the Soviet Union's growing preference for a purely conventional option. The Soviets realized that the use of theater nuclear weapons could only complicate operations. Russia has always favored maneuver and rapid progress as its main operational and tactical principles. They are therefore gradually abandoning the idea of using tactical nuclear weapons in favor of new conventional weapons. This is what we see today with super or hypersonic speed missiles. Russian operative art and tactics are therefore not based on nuclear weapons, but on concepts such as concentration of forces on the main axis, partial victory, and economy of forces. The concept of tactical nuclear weapons was essentially developed by the Americans in the 1960s in order to distinguish between weapons that could be used on the European continent and those that could affect the United States. To avoid reaching the point of nuclear holocaust, MAD, too quickly, strategies were devised to control a possible nuclear escalation. Both East and West equipped themselves with weapons that would keep the prospect of MAD at bay. In 1967, NATO adopted the flexible response strategy. Its purpose was to make it clear to the Soviets that the United States would not move directly and automatically to a strategic nuclear exchange. Indeed, despite its evolution over time and technologies, U.S. nuclear strategy retains one constant element, keeping the use of nuclear weapons off U.S. soil. This is why the Americans advocate a return of these weapons to the European theater, and why they are so insistent on the idea that the Russians are seeking to use tactical nuclear weapons in Ukraine. The difference in approach between the two superpowers is explained by the profoundly asymmetrical geostrategic situations of the USA and Russia. The USA can reach Russian territory with tactical, operational nuclear weapons, while Russia can only reach American soil with strategic or intermediate-range weapons. So, in the event of a major conflict, to avoid a strategic nuclear exchange affecting their territory, the USA would seek to keep a nuclear conflict in the European theater. To do this, they would carefully avoid directly hitting Russian national soil, so as not to trigger a strategic duel with Russia. Paradoxically, this dissymmetrical situation is also asymmetrical. By keeping the nuclear exchange at a tactical level, Russia can use low-intensity weapons in Europe, while the United States can only respond by striking the territory of its allies. It was this paradox that led to the Euro-missile crisis in the early 1980s and gave rise to the pacifist and anti-nuclear movement in Germany and Northern Europe. It culminated in the signing of the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, INF Treaty. Russian nuclear doctrine short-circuited American reasoning by declaring that no distinction can be made between tactical and strategic. Thus, the use of nuclear weapons on European soil, and a fortiori against Russia, could trigger an intercontinental retaliation. This is the essence of Russia's nuclear deterrent. Russia has adopted the USSR's consistent no-first-use policy. On the other hand, it has not specified, as France has, how it intends to deal with an escalation. This is the principle of deterrence. Russia's nuclear doctrine envisages the use of nuclear weapons only in the event of an existential threat to the Russian state, as specified in the presidential decree of June 2, 2020. The Russian Federation reserves the right to use nuclear weapons in response to the use of nuclear weapons and other weapons of mass destruction against it and/or its allies, as well as in the event of aggression against the Russian Federation, using conventional weapons, when the very existence of the state is threatened. The problem, in a nuclear exchange over short distances and therefore with short warning times, is to determine when the country is under existential threat, and therefore when to react. For this reason, the 2020 edition of Russia's nuclear doctrine somewhat lowered the level at which Russia can consider the use of nuclear weapons. Funnily enough, this is what Sweden and Finland have failed to understand. Their request to join NATO has been widely applauded, but in the event of war, these countries could be the first to be preemptively nuclearized. This is probably what motivated President Joe Biden's decision, at the end of March 2022, to abandon the no first use principle for nuclear weapons. Until then, the United States had considered the use of nuclear weapons solely for deterrence purposes, the sole purpose policy. But Joe Biden's decision leaves open the option of using nuclear weapons not only in retaliation for a nuclear attack, but also to respond to non-nuclear threats. Obviously, no Western media reported this major change in US nuclear policy. For example, the annual Swiss Security Report, published in September 2022 by the Swiss Federal Intelligence Service, SRC, says not a word about it. For the sake of clarity, we use English strategic terminology here, which is more refined than French terminology. A preemptive strike is launched when a confrontation is unavoidable, and it is thought that the adversary might strike. A preemptive strike is triggered when there are concrete indications that the adversary is going to strike, in the case of nuclear weapons, based on observations from surveillance satellites. Launch on warning is a shot fired while the opponent has already launched a missile and it's still in the air. As Vladimir Putin made clear at the Eurasian Economic Union Summit in Bishkek, Kyrgyzstan, in December 2022, the principle of nuclear engagement remains launch on warning, low. In other words, the triggering of nuclear watch systems on alert. In other words, while the Russians only plan to use nuclear weapons first in the event of an existential threat, the Americans allow themselves to do so at any time. As a result, Russia would use nuclear weapons if Moscow and the country's institutions were directly threatened. For example, a Ukrainian attack on Crimea would most likely not be considered existential for the Russian state. On the other hand, the USA could use nuclear weapons if one of its military bases came under attack. In October 2022, Volodymyr Zelensky inflamed passions by proposing to strike Russia to prevent the use of nuclear weapons. What should NATO do? Make it impossible for Russia to commit nuclear weapons. But the important thing is that I again call on the international community, as before the 24th February 2022, to strike preemptively, so that they know what will happen to them if they use them, and not, on the contrary, wait for Russia's nuclear strikes. Our media and fact-checkers then tried to water down Zelensky's speech. On the media site, 20minutes.fr, the expression preventive strike, preventivnij udar, clearly uttered by Zelensky, became preventive measures, which is literally disinformation. The claim that Zelensky is ready to start a nuclear conflict is denied by stating that he did not mention nuclear strikes. This is true, but irrelevant. It doesn't matter what kind of weapon he had in mind, because Russian nuclear doctrine provides for 19. The conditions determining the possibility of the use of nuclear weapons by the Russian Federation are as follows. Receipt of reliable information on the launch of ballistic missiles attacking the territories of the Russian Federation and or its allies. B. The use by the enemy of nuclear weapons or other weapons of mass destruction on the territory of the Russian Federation and or its allies. C. Enemy action on critical state or military facilities of the Russian Federation, the disabling of which would disrupt the response of nuclear forces. D. Aggression against the Russian Federation using conventional weapons when the very existence of the state is threatened. Zelensky's statements clearly fall within the scope of paragraph C. 4. Probably unaware of the scope of his speech, he called for a strike that makes the use of nuclear weapons impossible. Which, for Russia, could be precisely the reason to use them. Once again, our media are lying. The problem is that they systematically conceal information that could help us understand the situation. Let's recall here that during the conflict with Ukraine, contrary to what Jean-Philippe Schaller, a Swiss journalist accustomed to conspiracy, claimed, Vladimir Putin never mentioned nuclear weapons before Western leaders threatened to use them, like Liz Truss, then candidate for British Prime Minister, who declared herself ready to unleash a global annihilation. But the same journalist suggested that Russia wanted to use chemical weapons in Ukraine without any evidence. Here, we have the creation of fake news for the purposes of influence. Hybrid warfare. Russia's hybrid war is a carefully nurtured myth in the West, to which everyone has their own definition. It has become a catch-all concept, which our media and politicians, and even our generals, use to give an apparent coherence to events which, on the face of it, have nothing to do with each other. In technical terms, it's conspiracism. In 2017, Vladimir Putin told Le Figaro, "You mustn't invent imaginary threats from Russia, hybrid wars, or other such specters. You've invented them yourselves. You're scaring yourselves, and you're basing your policies on this imaginary data." The idea that Russia would have developed such a concept of hybrid warfare is based on the interpretation of an article written in 2013 by Valery Gerasimov, chief of the Russian General Staff, in an article entitled, "The Value of Science in Foresight." In fact, the original article was published in the Journal of the Academy of Military Sciences on January 26, 2013, under the title, "Main Trends in the Development of Forms and Methods of Employing Armed Forces and the Current Tasks of Military Science to Improve Them." It describes the evolution of wars as waged by the West against the Arab world, and the word hybrid does not appear in it. In fact, the term hybrid warfare originated in the West. Pseudo-experts and other journalists have tried to describe it without being able to understand what it might be, giving us a fuzzy, impalpable concept. After the Ukrainian crisis of 2014, Westerners were trying to make sense of a Russian invasion without Russian troops, a democratic revolution by far-right nationalist or even neo-Nazi militants, the legitimacy of a government that governed without having been elected, and so on. We then constructed a logic that brought together cyber warfare, terrorism, clandestine warfare, conventional warfare, and naturally, information warfare. Gerasimov's article then became the key to reading naturally incoherent events. Our journalists thus artificially created a doctrinal basis, which Le Point magazine claimed was validated by Vladimir Putin himself. We don't really know whether to condemn the journalists' racism or imbecility. In fact, the concept of hybrid warfare does not exist in Russian military thinking, and Russia has never theorized or invoked it. The problem came from Russia specialist Mark Galeotti, who first commented on Gerasimov's article and deduced from it the existence of a Gerasimov doctrine, supposedly illustrating the Russian concept of hybrid war. But in 2018, realizing the damage he had unwittingly caused, Galeotti apologized, bravely and intelligently, in an article entitled, "I'm Sorry I Created the Gerasimov Doctrine," published in Foreign Policy magazine. "I was the first to write about Russia's infamous high-tech military strategy. One small problem, it doesn't exist." To understand the idea of hybrid warfare, we need to go back to the typology of warfare. Without going into too much detail, conventional warfare is what we've known since the Second World War and for which our armies have prepared themselves. It's a war that uses a combination of land, air, and naval means to achieve objectives. Forces are engaged as a system. This is what is known as third-generation warfare, of which the Blitzkrieg, waged by the Germans in 1939-1940, is the archetypal example. At the end of the Cold War, when Western armies were engaged in insurgency-type conflicts against interventions they had themselves created, they were confronted by more rustic forces, even rudimentary guerrillas. These were the wars of the fourth generation. Fifth-generation wars are said to be non-kinetic, i.e., they take place without any real contact with the adversary. Cyber warfare, subversion and information warfare seek to subjugate the adversary by causing the collapse of his system. Although elements of this type of warfare have been present in every conflict since 1939, it remains largely a figment of the imagination. This is the vision of the war Ukraine expected to wage with Russia. Everyone, and common sense, knew that the Ukrainian army was in no position to defeat Russia on its own. The idea was to defeat Russia through a combination of sanctions, political and cultural economic isolation, and a narrative that would turn Russia into a pariah state. For the Russians, the vision is much clearer. Hybrid war is not a form of war that we choose, but the result of confrontation between two countries or entities that use different types of war. Thus, the confrontation between Russia and Ukraine is hybrid in nature, because Ukraine is trying to practice fifth-generation warfare, while Russia is in a third-generation conflict. In his article, Gerasimov analyzes the recent evolution of Western-led conflicts and draws lessons on how to integrate them into military thinking. His article is a methodological approach, not a description of how Russia would have incorporated these lessons into its doctrine. The concept of hybrid war offers an indefinite space that allows self-proclaimed experts of all stripes to create coherence around mostly unverified allegations and give logic to actions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.